The best choice in this case is choice E, pus puffy tumor. Let's look at some of the key features that make choice E the best answer here. Fluid collection, that's overlying the frontal calvarian. It's bright on flares, so there's not complete suppression like you see with CSF or pure fluid. On the post-contrast is REM enhancement. Also, you see there's diffuse enhancement in the surrounding subcutaneous tissue, so it shows you that there's diffuse inflammatory process. Also, you should notice that there's an intracranial involvement with the REM enhancing collection. That collection, as well as this extracranial collection, both shows restricted diffusion. So far, a REM enhancing collection, restricted diffusion, sounds like we're describing abscess, and that's exactly what this is. Probably the most important thing to know is that there is an epidural abscess. This fluid collection is continuous, as you can see here on flare. That's crossing midline. If this is a subdural abscess, a subdural fluid collection should be stopped by the fox and extend along the fox, not cross its midline, so this is an epidural abscess. For pus puffy tumor, its pathogenesis is from frontocalvarian osteomyelitis, that's forming a subperior osteo abscess, which in turn causes diffuse frontal swelling. So it presents as a swelling, in other words, a tumor. This is not a neoplasm. This is simply a description of the classic signs of acute inflammation, rubor, redness, dolor, pain, color, warmth, and tumor, which is swelling. So this is not a neoplasm. The most common cause by far is acute sinusitis. That's causing osteomyelitis of the adjacent frontal bone, and that causes in turn soft tissue swelling or subperior osteoabscess formation. Any other type of infection in this region, such as penetrating injury from trauma, surgery, or even bug bites, can also produce pus puffy tumor. The most important thing about pus puffy tumor, the reason why they can be so dangerous, is that their potential of intracranial extension. So you want to make sure you look for that when you see a pus puffy tumor. Make sure that you don't have an epidural abscess. Make sure that you don't see venous sinus thrombosis, is adjacent to the superior sagittal sinus. Also, inferiorly, you want to make sure that the bad sinusitis, especially the one that involving the ethmoid air cell, does not have an involvement of a post-septal orbital cellulitis. This is a different patient. On CT, you can see there's complete opacification of the frontal sinus, swelling of the interior soft tissue as well as the soft tissue adjacent to the orbit. On the post-contrast sagittal view, you can see a large subperior osteoabscess and a smaller epidural abscess, just like our patient. Notice that there's severe sinus disease, including complete opacification of the sphenoid sinus. Another thing to remember is that you do not need to have a complete bony destruction or a frank bony dehiscence to have infection spread both anteriorly and posteriorly. So on CT, just because you don't see a bony erosion does not mean that patient do not have an intracranial extension. Let's look at some other choices that do not work as well in this case. For choice A, epidermoid cyst, this is an example of a classic epidermoid cyst. It is bright on T2 just like a cyst. However, on flare, it does not suppress like a pure cyst or pure CSF-like cyst. In other words, it looks a bit dirty on flare sequence. It has bright signal on DWI, relatively dark signal on ADC, so there's some degree of reduced diffusion. Epidermoid cysts should have at most REM enhancement, should never have an internal enhancing soft tissue, and it does not cause surrounding inflammation or phlegma like in our case, and certainly you will not cause intracranial extension or intracranial infection. The only caveat being that epidermoid cysts can also get infected, and in that case, it can produce abscess. But all in all, I think choice A is not the best answer here. So what about choice B, thrombus sinus pericranii? For those of you who have not seen sinus pericranii before, it's a venous anomaly that has an abnormal communication between the intracranial venous sinuses with the extracranial venous structure connected by an intraosseous vein. It is a type of slow flow vascular malformation. This is an example of sinus pericranii. You can see there is a extraosseous collection or venous collection that has a direct communication with the torcula. For a thrombose sinus pericranii, of course, you can see filling defect within. However, you should not see surrounding inflammation like we see in this case. That makes choice B not as good of answer in this case. For intraosseous meningioma. Now, intraosseous meningioma should be solidly enhancing just like any type of meningioma you see. Yes, once in a while you can see cystic change with meningioma, but it's very strange to have a meningioma without any central enhancing component. This is an example of an intraosseous meningioma. Notice that the meningioma is engulfing the greater window sphenoid and the lateral orbital wall. And there's a relative preservation of the bony structure that is surrounding. Some people describe this as a fossil sign, as if there's a preserved fossil within a surrounding bone. That would be different than other type of metastases that tend to destroy the bone that is engulfing. So that's somewhat unique for intraosseous meningioma. And on CT, as you know, meningioma tend to elicit lots of hyperostosis, so they tend to have this expansion of the adjacent bone. Does not look like a meningioma. I'm going to rule out choice D for metastasis. Again, a cystic metastasis is possible, but not seeing any type of soft tissue component or enhancing soft tissue component make metastasis very unlikely in this case. So in the end, the best choice is E, pus puffy tumor. I hope you find this helpful, and good luck on your board exam. Thank you.